this afternoon. So we're actually going to have sort of perspectives from practice first. So we have Dorothy Francis from CASE, the Cooperative and Social Enterprise Development Agency, and Bob Cannell from SUMA, retired now and currently working for the Cooperative Business Consult.
CBC.
Both of them are going to talk a little bit about their experiences and I think respond to some of the issues that Ed raised with us this morning. Martin, was there anything that you wanted to say? You're sitting in the front looking like you're a part of a panel.
Oh, I thought I was chairing.
Yeah, no, that's fine. That's good. Right, okay, in that case, I will end the introduction. Martin will chair the Q&A afterwards. We've got 15 minutes per speaker, if that's all right, about 15 minutes for conversation. Then we'll have Marisol and Giza giving us a more academic perspective from research. Again, 15 minutes each with 15 minutes for Q&A. We'll take a break and we'll have then time to actually discuss this and feedback after the session. So take your notes and just kind of keep the questions fairly quick and on clarification rather than the big discursive things we can pick up after.
Yes. Okay, so concentrating on what Chris was just saying, neither Bob or Dorothy are going to do presentations. They'd rather respond to questions from the audience. But I thought it'd be helpful just to start off, if each of you could just talk for 5 minutes about your experiences and what you do now, I think, just to sort of introduce yourself to the audience, and then we'll get a discussion going. Whoever wants to go first.
Right. My name is Dorothy Francis, and as I said in the introduction, I work for the Cooperative and Social Enterprise Agency, which is a business support, training, advice, and mentoring service for to promote cooperatives and social enterprises. We primarily concentrate on cooperatives, that's where our heart lies. However, in the 1990s, the term social enterprise was introduced, and we found that increasingly we weren't getting contracts because people were saying, well, you do co-ops, don't you, but you don't do social enterprise. As Ian pointed out earlier, all cooperatives are social enterprises, not necessarily all social enterprises are cooperatives. So in doing cooperatives, of course, we were doing social enterprise. So it led to a change in our name, which was when we stopped being the CDA, who some people in this room, Tanya, Ian, Bob and others, Ed, I know, will remember us as, and we became CASE, which stands for Cooperative and Social Enterprise. We just trade as CASE. We're on the Crescent on King Street, if you want to come and see us, just near in the city centre, just about 5 minutes from Phoenix, so do drop in and see us if you'd like. I'll hopefully talk a little bit more about my background in co-ops later on, but just to say that I've worked within the cooperative movement for nearly all of my working life, having sought it out from about the age of 19. When I was 19, I worked for the General Post Office, as it was then, the GPO. So that's dated itself, isn't it? Because the GPO has not been an entity for many, many years. But at that time, getting a job at the GPO for a black girl from a council estate in Coventry, first generation immigrant, was seen as a kind of like a gold star job. It was a job, it was deemed to be a job for life. And I liked working for the GPO, but I remember thinking there has to be another way to work. There has to be a different way to work. I want to change the way I work. I don't want to be a small cog in a large organisation. There must be a more democratic process, a process where I'm more involved in what I do on a day-to-day basis, a process where I get back what I put in, where I get a fair return on my labour. Those were my 19-year-old musings. I knew that that setup wasn't for me, but I didn't know what the setup was, you know, if there was another setup, and if so, what it was called. I left the GPO to go to university, again, quite then decided, seen as quite a bold change, you know, to leave a job like that and to go to uni, but I knew I wanted to do it different. I came out of uni and I still didn't know what I wanted to do. I just knew how I wanted to do it, but I still didn't know the words cooperative. And I found out about it almost by accident, something which I'm going to talk about a little bit later on in an anecdote. And it was like somebody had turned the light on, somebody had turned on a light bulb. And I remember being introduced to cooperative working and saying, you can do that. That is actually a structure. And being told, yes, it is. And that was it. So I was 23 at that point. I'm nearly 56 now. And I have never worked in anything except cooperative since. Everything I've done throughout my adult working life has been in the cooperative sector. Because for me, it fits in so many ways. As a person of colour, as a woman, and 30 odd years ago, as a young woman, for me, ownership and control is where it fits. Those are words you'll hear often when you talk about the cooperative movement. It's about ownership, it's about control. And for me, ownership of my working life is ownership of my life per se. And for me, they go hand in hand. And so that is why I work in the cooperative movement, because I need that ownership, that control, that democracy. For me, I can't separate out the two. I can't live 8 hours in a horrible job because I know I've got a social life afterwards. The two have to merge. And I've been very, very fortunate to have spent most of my working life in the field of cooperative development, in the field of helping others to set up cooperatives. And I have worked with some to set up some cooperatives which are celebrating their 30th birthdays this year. Some of them you'll know, such as Soft Touch, Leicester Whole Food Cooperative, Complete Wasters, Shepshire Carers, and others that I've worked with who are between 20 to 30 years old. And so we're in this as a cooperative and as a cooperative development agency. We're in this for the long haul. We don't just set up businesses for a year or two. We want them to be sustainable. We want to create a movement. We want to be able to show the cooperative work and promote what we do through the practicalities of what we do. So we're a small agency. I answered a question over lunch, which was, how are you funded? And I said, we're not funded. It's a misconception that agencies such as ours are funded. There's no central funding for organisations like us or any local or any coordinated local authority funding. We are a small business. We're a cooperative in our own rights at Case, and that we felt it should be do as we do, not do as we say. And so we actually formulated as a cooperative right back in the early 80s, using a set of rules that we wrote ourselves with assistance from Ian Snaith here, way back in the early 80s, they were then called the Yellow Rules, or more often called the Leicester Model Rules. So we wrote our own rules for a small, flat, fully inclusive cooperative, which we registered under and are still registered under those rules. So we are a cooperative ourselves, operating that way, because we feel that it's central to what we do. And in fact, I would argue that if we were not a cooperative, we would not be here. Our business would not have survived the slings and arrows that have been thrown at us over the years if we were not a cooperative business. So we're a small business. We bid for contracts on the open market. We act as a cooperative. We are a cooperative. And we support others to set up. Hopefully that's my intro.
That's great. Thank you very much, Dorothy. Okay. That's really clear. Bob, do you want to do something similar?
Yeah. How did I get into co-ops? Well, it was due to a fairly competent PhD supervisor. I was a postgrad at Bradford Uni, and I was taking full advantage of being a full-time student to just wander around the library and everywhere else reading anything I liked. And I was doing something vaguely social science-ish, having had a first degree in biology, and I started getting interested in how to control business so it wasn't wrecking the world. And then I came across co-ops, and I thought, what a fantastic idea. So I started researching co-ops, which had nothing to do with what I was supposed to be doing, but he didn't bother really, he just let me do it. So at the end of 3 years, I had boxes of handwritten notes which had nothing to do with the subject I was supposed to be doing, the topic I was supposed to be researching, and I went and got a job with Suma, which was the biggest worker co-op at the time, very trendy, very radical, and well paid in Leeds. And Suma's a distributor and wholesaler of whole foods and health foods. And been there ever since. I've just recently retired. For the last 20 years, I worked part-time doing other things, doing cooperative support, representing worker co-ops on the board of Cooperatives UK and on the European Confederation and on the World Federation as well. And at the same time, being personnel manager or personnel officer at SUMA, trying to get order into what was in the 90s very chaotic management structure. And it all came together. It just sort of clicked in the middle 90s, and SUMA transformed into this really rapidly growing, really powerful, efficient, productive business, generating extraordinary amounts of value from what is basically a distribution business. It's nothing special, it's nothing high tech. It's now, well, when I joined, I think it had about 9-10 members, and it's now got 180 members, 250 people on the books, 50 million turnover and exports to 50 countries, and with hundreds of own label products, and is the biggest distributor of fair trade products in the country by number of lines. So there are other people who do big volume, but nobody does the number of lines that SUMA does. And I'm now full-time mentoring co-ops, helping co-ops, promoting co-ops, and getting more involved in some of the academic side of it, because it's always been a puzzle to me why some of these things work and work brilliantly, and others in exactly the same situation stumble and never really get going. And you know, I'm very interested in the management techniques and culture of the different cooperatives. And because we've got this sunrise of all these amazing new internet-enabled co-ops, platform co-ops and stuff like that coming along. So SUMA was one of the radical 1970s co-ops that revolutionized the idea of co-ops in Britain, because the old style were the retail consumer co-ops, shops, and we had all these radical anarchist worker co-ops, and now we've got a new model, these internet-enabled platform co-ops and network co-ops, which are just as exciting and could be just as revolutionary or not. You know? So I'm curious to know about all that stuff whilst trying to get the worker co-ops to actually work better, because I think it's a fantastic way to work. And God knows this country needs some better businesses.
Thank you, Bob. That's great. Can I just start off by pitching a question of my own, and then other people generally just sort of chip in whenever you feel so moved. So one of the gambles of this workshop, I guess, is the idea that civil society, whatever we might mean by that term, is under attack in a variety of ways. But that one of the ways in which we might imagine reinvigorating it is through the workplace. Yeah? So the idea that the cooperative itself gives people more of a stake in their workplace, and perhaps consequently more of a sense of efficacy or power or whatever in more generalized senses of engaging in civil society. Do you think that's true?
Okay. It doesn't, I think. One of the joys of doing personnel or somewhere like SUMA is you get people who are really bright but have never got through the education system. So you get someone who's only ever driven a truck, and I helped design selection systems that looked for people like that. And you get these people, and then suddenly, and then you say to them, you can do anything here. If you can do it, you can do it. You know, whatever it is you're keen on, if there's an opening, if we need it, you can do it. You don't have to come in as an IT technician. And we've had people who have just blossomed into really multi-skilled, competent people, and some of them leave. And they come in as a truck driver, and they go out running their own IT consultancy. You know, it with all the business skills as well as the technical stuff. So the joke is you get some bright young person not that long out of uni, get gets into Zoom and within 18 months they're on the management committee telling 60-year-olds what to do. And, you know, wow. You get that sort of personal development, and I think it translates out into wider society, but being in a big worker cooperative can be all-consuming and completely exhausting, so maybe they don't have to have as much time and energy outside as they do inside.
Yeah, I think cooperatives try to impact on the wider society. It's one of the seven cooperative principles. We have concern for community, and also another principle is that we educate the community. And so cooperatives do try to do that. Like you say, they've got, when you're running your own business all day, it can be hard to go out. But most of the co-ops I know do actually take part in what we do to be civil society, involvement in organisations, in giving, in volunteering, in giving back. Recognising that what they do is a contribution in itself to civil society, to building society. So just simply running a cooperative is a contribution. You don't need to do much else.
It's also very good in business terms as well. People go, how can you pay the wages you pay? Because full-time gross at Zoom is £40,000 a year. People go, I can't believe that. And you go, well, look at the car park. There's no Bentleys in it, are there? There's some fairly nice BMWs, but there's no Bentleys and Ferraris. And so that gets the message across to people that actually, in normal businesses, the people who control them are taking most of the value out of the business. And if you share it around, then it is possible for everybody to have a good standard of living. And I mean, I love going to business conferences and, you know, you go and say, what's your rate of return on capital? Well, 15%, well, that's nothing, mine's 30. And I go, last year was 120%. And you go, what? Yeah, 120%, three times apples. You know, it's that sort of thing when you get you can do in a worker co-op when everybody's working together and you don't have expensive management. And that's really good to say to other people.
And that reminds me of something I used to experience when I was training as a personnel officer. Whilst I've been at the agency, I qualified variously as a teacher and as a personnel officer, which is something I share with Bob.
Yeah, I did it too.
We're amongst a very few within the movement who are members of the Chartered Institute of Personnel and Development. I did my course over 3 years whilst taking day release whilst working at the agency, so studying from 12:30 till 9:30, one day a week. And I, on my course, we're going back some years now, but there was the Coal Board, the Post Office, NHS, local authorities, etc. And they never fully understood cooperatives, never fully understood what I did. And they would ask me the same question year in, year out. What do you do about your high rates of attrition, your high rates of sickness, and absenteeism, and poor performance? And I'd say nothing. And they'd say, why not? And I'd say, because we don't have it. I don't know what you're talking about.
That's right.
I don't have a high rate of sickness in my organisation. I said, do you know the biggest problem I have with sickness in my organisation? Is that there is not a single person that I work with. I'm the CEO, the manager of the organisation. There's not a single person I work with who I've not had to send home because they're too sick to be on work. If they say, therefore, if they ring in sick, I know that they're nearly dying. And they could have their sick pay. So, but for 3 years, they asked me that. But for 3 years, whenever I tried to explain cooperatives, whenever we had management modules and I stood up and I made my presentation, which of course was from a cooperative background, because that's what I'm going to promote. And of course I'm going to promote that, because within days of being on the course, I realized that the course was not written for me. It was not about me. On the question that I was sent out was, what can academics do? One thing you can do is recognise that the cooperative movement exists. because I signed up to a 3-year CIPD course and realised that I was not reflected in it in any way at all, that the CIPD is not for me, it's an employer organisation, and it's actually against the employees, it's against the things that we stand for. So of course I presented properties at every aspect, and even though I presented the positive elements, I'd go, yeah, that all sounds fine, I can't see how it would work. Can't see how it works. And then they'll say to me, what do you do about your high sickness? Like, what do you do about this? What do you say? So they could never weigh up the two and say, of course, yes, of course it can work. And of course it's an answer. They were very, always very resistant to it. It's an unusual paradox, I think.
So, got questions now. So, if you haven't spoken before, can you just say who you are? So I've got Dan first.
Yeah, I'm Daniel King. Very interested in what you're both saying about sort of your background, how you got into being part of co-ops. I wonder whether that you both seem to have a propensity towards cooperative ways of working. And so I just wonder from an HR point of view then, recruiting people, do you look for cooperative attributes, and could anybody join a co-op if the culture is strong enough, or is it that actually certain people are more likely to work in that sort of way, particularly drawing on what Ed said this morning about that we're in a world of neoliberalism where people are increasingly taught the value of competition as opposed to cooperation. I'm saying this just as I'm a member of Woodcraft, which is a youth movement for cooperation. We're trying to instill that in children aged 5, 6 yeah. and stuff. But those who maybe haven't had those sort of experiences, if they walked into a cooperative but with a neoliberal mindset of competition, would that work? Or do you try to look at people with cooperative mentalities?
I think that if people have cooperative mentalities, it works better. I think people can learn about cooperatives, but I think the mentality is important. Now, that is what we look for. We can build other skills. We will take people into the organisation who don't necessarily have the skills that we want, but they must have the belief. I was saying to Bob when we were chatting earlier that, in my opinion, being in a cooperative is almost, it's values-based. It's about a value system. It's almost a belief system. It's an ethos, it's a faith, it's something you believe in and want to do. And that, if that is missing, then they are, we'll find it very, very difficult to incorporate them into a cooperative. I was also talking with Bob about the fact that the fact that cooperation should be taught earlier in schools. It should be taught in universities, but even by then it's too late. It should be taught in schools very early on so that young people are aware of it. I think sometimes, I talked about the fact that I was questing for cooperatives when I was 19 and wanted to work in a cooperative format. I wanted to change the way I worked. I didn't know what it was called, but I knew that it was something that I wanted to do. But when I look back at it, I realised that actually the idea of cooperation was probably planted in my head long before by my mother. Now, if you want a business, a management guru, then I'm going to suggest my mother as one of my roles. She's a woman, first generation immigrant to this country, a woman who never did a job grander than catering or cleaning in her life, but actually instilled quite a lot of management principles in us and a lot of cooperative principles. And I remember the way that she brought us up, like the fact that I have three sisters and a brother, and we were never ever allowed to have anything to ourselves. She said, nothing is too small to share. If we went out of the house and somebody gave us a fox's mint, and a fox's mint. If somebody gave us a mint, we were not allowed to eat it ourselves. We had to bring it back and share it with our siblings. Have you ever tried to cut a fortunately, there are only four of us at home, but my older sister is much older, so it was quarters, which made life a lot easier rather than fifths. But have you ever tried to cut a fox's mint into four? It shatters. It doesn't matter. She would say, you've got to cut it into four. If somebody gave us an apple, it was cut into four. She said, you will cooperate. You will act as a unit. You are not disparate individuals, you are siblings, you are a family, and you will act as a family. Whatever you have is shared with the rest of the family. And she used to do this thing, which was occasionally, we'd always have our meals around the table, and occasionally she'd call us down to the table. We'd run down the stairs and then screech to a halt at the door to realise with horror that she had unexpectedly done it again. She would put our entire meal on one large plate, and she would make the four of us eat off one plate. I am 3, 4, and 7 years older than my siblings, and it's a challenge because she'd say, you have got to, the 7-year-old, when I'm 14, the 7-year-old has got to be able to eat her portion, you eat your portion, the other brother and sister eat their portion, you have got to, and she said, you've got to learn to cooperate. She said, you must learn to cooperate, your brothers and sisters, and you said, you'll take this into the world of work. You need to learn to cooperate. And it was a challenge, and we hated it. I'd like to say, oh yes, we understood all this, and we hated it, this idea of having to eat off one plate. But to give you another little anecdote, my brothers and sisters and I are very, very close. We have what we call sibling lunches. In fact, we have one this coming Friday, when those of us who work take a day off work, and we meet, the five of us, we meet for lunch, and just to chat. And we did that a few years ago, in an Italian restaurant. After we'd been there a few hours, we realised that the lights had been dimmed. We turned round and realised that all the waiters were lined up, the entire place was empty, everybody else had gone home. And we thought, oh my goodness. So we quickly pulled our money together, gave it to my brother to pay the proprietor. My brother came back to the table and he gave us our money back. And we said, why haven't you paid? He said, the proprietor has given us the meal for free. I said, why? Even though we've kept him after hours, even though the restaurant is closed. And he said, yes. He said, he'd said to him, are these your sisters? And he said, yes. And he said, I'm Italian, I love the idea of family, and I just think it's great, the fact that you love each other so much, you're so absorbed in each other, you didn't even realise the restaurant was shut. You didn't have this meal on me. Oh. So I think that's a testament to my mother and to the way she brought us up in cooperation, and I feel that in some ways, because that was coming back to what you were saying about the woodcraft folk, etc., 5 and 6 year old, that's when it needs to be instilled into you, I think. I'm not saying you can't come to it at a later date, but I think one of the issues that I have with this country is that the sector that I work in seems to be seen as an add-on, a bolt-on, something odd and unusual, left-wing, liberal, something that you do whilst munching down on your lentils. It isn't seen as mainstream, it isn't promoted in the very early stages. And when I look back on my mother's management practices, on her cooperative practices, I realised the fact that I was unhappy at 19 was that she'd seeded that in me from that point, and that basically there wasn't a way for me to work. So I don't know if I quite answered your question. I've talked about lots of different things, but anyway,
when you were in the Italian restaurant, were you all eating off one plate? Maybe that's why the meal was free. Can I get Bob to respond to
I've been involved in Woody's for 30-odd years, and I think that Woody's is the best way of promoting cooperation in children. And yes, of course, there's that explicit, teaching cooperation. But there's also the implicit skills of self-organisation without hierarchy, which I think is very difficult for people to learn. People are conditioned to either be leaders, public schools and all that, or led everybody else. And that's a major problem, getting people to understand that they are leaders and led at the same time. It's constant interplay. There's not one and then the other. It's all the time. And that's something we force people to experience it sooner when they're training. They have to constantly judge, am I leading here or am I following? What's going on here? And we select for what SUMA members have decided are membership qualities, things like taking part in management, self-development and taking responsibility, communication skills and working for the collective good. And we actually select on those. We tend not to select on technical ability. it's much easier to teach a co-operator how to do financial management than teach a financial manager how to be a co-operator. And people go, so well, what about the finance director? You must have a finance director. No, we don't. Because finance directors are 120 grand a year and we're flat wage and we're not paying somebody more than everybody else because then they'd end up being the boss. So split the job up, have three people doing it. And even if each of them is only half as intelligent as a finance director, we've still got 50% more intelligent than three people if they work together. You need a variety of people. I mean, I'm not a very cooperative person. When I do assessments, I come out quite poor in terms of cooperation. And you don't want everybody like being on the thingy scale, what's that called, the company worker, you know, just keeps everybody happy. You need somebody, you need the full range of the Belbin archetypes, you know. But all of those people need to recognise that they have to do that together. I mean, what we do in Zuma is they actually do that. So you get a project, you take it on. If you've been used to being a manager in other businesses and telling people what to do, you have to learn that actually it's much more political in Zuma. You have to learn how to gain and encourage support for people for your idea. So if you use big fancy words, no one understands it, can't be bothered to find out what they mean, got other work to do. You have to be able to learn how to communicate. You cannot rely on authority to get people to agree. And if you're just used to being told what to do, it will be, well, come on, get on with it. Job needs doing. You're never going to become a member if you don't make a move on that. But I've never done anything like this before. Well, we're going to see some progress. You know? You won't maybe not succeed, but we want to see you've learned that you can take initiative and you can do things. And everybody's got their own things. Some people love to do strategic planning and stuff like that. It's really esoteric and abstract. And other people like sorting out the brooms and cleaning materials in the warehouse. And why is one better than the other? You know, the brooms and cleaning materials has a benefit in the next half hour.
Got a question over there, go at the back.
Okay, I'm Ian Hewitt and arrived late. Pleased to be able to join you from Nottingham this morning. I'm very concerned about the potential for neoliberal capital to expand and enclose the co-op movement. So it could use cooperation as the next level of expansion. The co-op movement's had a tradition of being fiercely anti-voracious capitalism. I think the example I can give from Nottingham is that during the Spanish Civil War, the Nottingham Society, the Greater Nottingham Society, clubbed together and bought an ambulance to support the forces of the Republic, the anti-fascist movement. So it's a proud history. On Friday, I attended a meeting in Nottingham at which we were trying to find out what's happening with the NHS. So 44 areas, counties of England are going to basically dismember the NHS in their area, and they're doing it in secret. So up until Thursday night at 10:30, there was no prospect of knowing what was going to happen in Nottingham, but it appeared on the 10:30 news. On Friday, I had to rewrite my motion to try and get the information about what's likely to happen. £600 million has been taken out of the budget over the next 5 years, and it's likely that the NHS at the moment is looking to dismember health service provision. So the NHS as a provider of health is looking to create a planned process of diminishing health. So the health is going to get worse. Now, as part of that, the expectation is that civil society and social enterprises and probably cooperatives are expected to make up this £600 million shortfall by some magical means. Okay? And my concern is that employing new technologies, that employing the discipline of the market is going to be possible to entrench or to enclose those social endeavours that are going to be targeted and directed and put under a lot of pressure to deliver that service with minimal resource, using the techniques and the social interchange that cooperatives and social enterprise provide. So if we're not careful, I think the expectation is a bit bleak in that scenario. And I'm just, so civil society and cooperatives are maybe under the cosh of neoliberal capitalism. And I'm just wondering how we're going to respond to that in ways that enable us at some point to get back to the situation the Great Nottingham Co-op Society was in the 1930s.
Yeah. That's a big question. Let's see whether you can answer that one.
We both agree it's a very big question.
We're not sure if we can answer it.
I don't really want to start, to be honest. That's a big political debate. Well, you just get my personal political opinions on it. I think one of the things we have to do is to, as we were saying this morning, stick to the cooperative principles, part of which is that co-ops, but certainly worker co-ops, shall not be used to undermine other workers' wage rates, shall not be labour-only co-ops which can be exploited. The co-ops have to be independent and autonomous, so the idea that a co-op is dependent on a diminishing contract price, well, that's indirect. From a single customer, that's in direct contravention of cooperative principle 4. And think of other ways, radically different ways. I mean, we've always said, if you're in a game with someone, with an opponent who's so big, so powerful, so clever, you haven't got a hope of winning, don't go down in glorious defeat, play another game. Here comes politics. You know, Arthur Scargill and the NUM went down in glorious defeat. They marched into oblivion in the miners' strike. Tower Colliery said, "We're not doing that." And they worked with the Tories, got control of their pit in South Wales, and ran it for another 13 years. They controlled it. And had another 13 years of good employment and got some money into the local community to build industrial estate and training units so there were jobs when the pit finally closed. Now, that wasn't glorious defeat, that was outwitting capitalists. And I think we've got to do stuff like that. So let's not just convert hospitals into co-ops and then see them squeezed ever more. Let's, as I said this morning, let's look to alternative models like the Saikatsu Club Network in Japan, where people are both consumers and producers, where there's no division between employee and service user, where it's not transactional, it's relational. We can do different models because we're not bound by the logic of money.
Well, you might have said you weren't going to answer the question, but you just did. Do you want to pitch in there?
I don't have much to add to that except to say that I don't really feel that it's our responsibility as cooperatives to sop up the messes of society. That's not what cooperatives exist for. They're not there to help any particular government out of messes. They're there to provide an alternative way of working. And yes, we can be radical, and so I would share what Bob says, that what we need to do is look at radical new ways of working, but not to be seen as an antidote to problems, because that's not what the movement's for. And therein lies problems, and therein lies the blame as well, because if cooperatives then take up that slack when things go wrong, it's blamed on it, on the fact that it's a cooperative, not on the fact that they were pushed off the cliff in the first place.
Okay, I've got a question over here.
I was going to ask a very simple question, Jan, but just to follow it from yours, until that other comments from Mr. Room came. It's an enormous question about how people who witness something like that happening respond. There was a phrase earlier that I think Ed used about the internalised psychology of capitalism. And it's a very interesting phrase, the internalised psychology of capitalism. The way that we assume certain things are natural, normal, self-evident, and those things include selfishness and aggression. And when you ask, so that's my comment about that, we don't have to fight them on their terms. We can fight in other ways by showing empathy and kindness. They're very powerful things. We're told that they're not by that internalised psychology. It tells us that kindness doesn't work. It tells us that people can't work together in this way. But actually, my evidence, I'm sure the evidence of a lot of people's experience in this room, is that people can. And that's what, to return to your initial question that you asked about, what happens when you appoint someone who doesn't, who is full of these neoliberal tales, these narratives? What's been your experience of working with people like that?
With people who...
Who are, on that, to the right, who
are self-interest.
Okay. Yeah. We don't actually... I don't actually have much experience of employing people like that. I do have one interesting anecdote of employing somebody who's completely wrong. We try not to employ people who we know inherently are wrong. And you can tell this quite early on. You can tell it through their reactions, through the words they use. We made one disastrous appointment, and it was only afterwards when we went over her interview that we realised that everything she said throughout it was I. Whereas we made an appointment of somebody who was only 23 years old, the second job out of uni, and it was we and us all the way through his interview. The language was so very different, and we knew he was going to be a good appointment. Just simply because of the language he used and the way he approached the questions, the way he approached issues. So we try not to, but of course you do make disastrous appointments. You can be a CIPD, as trained as you want, you can have been there as many years as you want, but you'll still make mistakes. One mistake, well, I don't know if it was a mistake, I think, let's admit it was a mistake. We had a contract with a local authority, but something else came up. We wanted to second the person who was running that contract to the new project that we had. So we did that, but it left that project with 6 months to go before it could be concluded. So we needed somebody to step into the breach just for 6 months. We interviewed, there was nobody really right in it, nobody who had that mindset, we just knew it. They were wrong. But we couldn't afford within that short time period to re-interview, so we took the best of the bunch. In inducting him, I said, it's our policy that even if we have people just for a few months, we try to create work around them, try to create employment around their skills. So for instance, we had a colleague, Nizam, who we took on board for 6 months initially. But Nizam speaks fluent Bengali and Hindi as well as English, and has lots of networks within local communities. And so we took the project to the local regional development agency and said we'd like to develop co-opters amongst the Bangladesh community using the skills that we have in the agency. And we were able to secure a role for Nizam, and he stayed with us for 5.5 years until he chose to leave. So I explained this to this individual and said, this is what, if you want to stay with us, we will try to get you to stay with us. Towards the end of the 6 months, I met with him and I said, you've made no overtures, I've asked you again and again. You haven't come back to me to say whether or not you want to stay at Case, whether or not, I didn't want him to stay, but I had to give him the opportunity. And his response left me flabbergasted. He said, no, I don't want to stay with you. And I said, why not? He said, well, when you appointed me, you told me it was a business advisor's job. I said, it is. You advise businesses. He said, yes. He didn't tell me I'd have to work with poor people.
Okay.
And
yeah.
I was astounded. That is it was just so very obvious. That person, no matter how long he spent with us, he was never going to be a true cooperator because he just didn't have the principles at heart. He didn't have the values. He didn't understand that poor people can create very good businesses. One of the best businesses, we have a large business in Shepshed called Shepshed Carers. They provide domiciliary care for local people in Shepshed, Loughborough and Colville. It was started by two people, Pauline Graves and Sarah Sanders, who self-described themselves as thick. when I first met them 20 odd years ago, they said, people like us don't run business, do they, Dorothy? And I said, why not? They said, we're two thick working class women from Shepshed. We haven't got a single certificate to our name. Sorry, yeah, we have. We've both got a certificate which shows that we can swim a length of the baths. So that's the only certificate they had. And yet, those two self-described thick women have gone on to run a business which employs over 100 people, was voted Social Enterprise of the Year, invited to number 10 to find out how what they do can be replicated. They have ministers and people visiting them from over the country all the time to learn from them. They provide employment for 100 people within the local area. They keep money in that local area. They help people to remain in employment. People like me who have an elderly mother, they can come out and care for that person, enabling me to remain in my job instead of having to give it up. And this was started by two poor people, and you need to understand that, you know, that everybody has it within them to cooperate. Yeah. Mm. And that's what that person couldn't understand. So hopefully that answers your question. You can't train people to cooperate, I don't think.
And I think we better stop there because we've got to move on to the next section. Sorry, we'll have more time to talk, don't worry, it's more built in. But we've now got two academic presentations. Have we talked about who's going first?
Okay.